Out of the Soho club scene of the early 80s came a new wave of stand-up comedians who were to change the face of British humour. Angry, anarchic, and more right-on than the Socialist Workers' Party, the alternative comedians overthrew the old comedy order.
Neil, the bathroom's free, unlike the country under the Thatcherite junta.
The whole thing about alternative comedy when it first started was it was genuinely subversive.
Neil, are these lentils South African?
They were making fun of the comedians that had gone before who were sexist and racist and homophobic.
I suppose you hate gay people too, hippie!
Alternative comedy was all about getting rid of all that and being different.
Did you see that? Did you? The voice of
but
you!
But while the angry lefties of alternative comedy had little time for TV, others were quick to cash in.
If you want to open a bank account, you've got to look smart.
Obviously, through the 80s and 90s, you had the rise of the alternative comedy circuit and the stand-up circuit. So it was only natural that advertising would then look to those ideas and those models, especially if it was targeting younger people.
I would like to open a bank account, please.
And here you have Viv from The Young Ones, the punk, the supposed rebel, actually trying to sell a bank, which is just bizarre.
The thought of Ade Edmondson as Vivian advertising NatWest doesn't strike me as being an essentially subversive thing to do. And, you know, surely an advert for an enormous corporate bank can't possibly incorporate what really drove alternative comedy on.
Don't believe everything.
It was funny to middle-aged or older people to see this punk being ridiculed, and also for the younger people at work because they instantly recognise him from The Young Ones.
Comedy characters have, you know, quite often have a short shelf life anyway, so it's like, well, you may as well, like, loads of money. Ideal for Harry Enfield just to cash in on that.
Right, this bird shows me a seconda. She says, would Sir care to try it on? I goes, all right, darling, but let's see the watch first.
The great thing about that advert is that he's standing there with the wad of cash that he's about to get paid for doing the advert. That's surely what he's just going, look, this is what I'm getting, that's why I'm doing it.
Alternative comedy became the new comic currency, and as British Telecom was about to find out, engaging with comedy characters could set bells ringing.
You can't pick up a phone and dial. You got maybe something wrong with your finger. It's an allergic reaction to telephones.
Well, I suppose BT is built around just one very strong comic character. The idea of the mother always wanting her son to call her and who never does. That obviously is something which is familiar to everyone, but the fact that it's the Jewish mother who's this great sort of comedy archetype just increases that and takes it to the nth degree.
A phobia. You're telephobic.
One of the briefs, I think the first one I picked up, was about, you know, have you phoned your mother recently? That was this sort of idea. And if you were Jewish and you looked at that, it would be the very first thing that came into your head, I think. And so that was the first thing that came into my head. But, of course, the thing about the phone is, it is a kind of umbilical cord, it's a control mechanism. So that's why it works, because, you know, this woman is basically trying to control everybody through the phone.
Maths, English, physics, geography, German, woodwork, art. I failed.
But even Beattie failed to connect with viewers at first.
Pottery? Very useful.
We thought it was a terrific idea, and we made, I think, 6 ads in one batch. And we took them to research.
I don't think anybody in the room laughed, about 27 people, and nobody laughed once. With many of the ones that, well, people remember, the Ology commercial and the Mrs. Jones thing, all those things, and nobody laughed or even... And that's very, very dispiriting, to put it mildly.
There was this instant kind of reaction of she's too grasping and she's too pushy.
But someone, I think it was a guy called Les Harris, I think he was the guy, the pivotal person at BT, who eventually said that we should run them. There were others, you know, BT involved as well, but I believe he was the one who actually pushed the button in the end.
We felt that once people got used to her on air and she became part of life, you know, that actually people's attitudes would change. And we took a risk. It was a big risk, but it paid off.
Beattie became one of advertising's most successful campaigns, yet some viewers still refused to pick up on the joke. For them, the overbearing Jewish mother was too much of a cartoon.
Bagels, latkes, pickled herring, chicken soup, accountants, lawyers, bagels.
And do you have the 14 in the blue?
I thought Madam was a 12.
It is very
Yiddish humour. You know, it's like, you know, what size have you got? Well, you know, no, what size are you? Well, what size have you got? It's that kind of thing. It's, but it's not offensive. It's amusing. It's observing, because people do have those characteristics.
I don't have a problem with it being a Jewish grandmother or, you know, the fact that she's trying to get a bargain. And people always say to me, you know, was it your mother? No, it wasn't, but it had enormous, you know, overtones of that kind of woman, you know, who never ever makes up her mind. And the thing about the part of it that was my mother is the fact that she just never assumed she was giving anyone any trouble.
Yes, we have a 14 in the blue.
And in the white?
And in the white, and in the green, and in the pink.
If she was a stereotype, she wasn't quite a stereotypical of what we thought she was. You know, it was a more universal stereotype than we imagined at the time.
If you take every stereotype and cliche out of comedy, there's no comedy, because comedy is all about identifying with something that's true.
As long as you do it with tact and tastefully and in the right tone, then I don't think people should really get offended. But as you know, people do get offended over the smallest things.
By the early 90s, offending people was well and truly back on the menu. The arrival of the sex-mad Men Behaving Badly saw women yet again reduced to fantasy figures.
Fantastic. I think the situation now is we've kind of gone beyond feminism, haven't we? I think we've gone, I mean, I don't say beyond in the sense of we all think it's wrong and it was all a load of rubbish. I think we've just learned to accept it, you know. Now, really, we're in a situation where you can use those stereotypes now, but everyone assumes you're being ironic. So you could probably literally have, you know, a blatantly sexist setup that you would see in a 70s ad. You could probably use it right now. And people would go, oh, that's funny, they've used a 70s style sexist setup. So I just think everyone would assume now you're being clever.
With things being so tight at the moment, my husband persuaded me to take a second job.
The makers of this cinema ad for Harley Davidson motorbikes thought they were being clever when they gave the expression sending the wife out to work a whole new twist.
It's only funny because it's played the way it is, that she's sort of the happy hooker and everything's fine. Because, you know, if you played the ad with her kind of being quite miserable about her lot, it would be just one of the most vile, appalling pieces of film ever made.
Oh, one good thing, though. Next time.
It's completely ridiculous, but it's very dark humour, and that's why I like it. I think the casting of that was superb. She's so innocent and upbeat about the whole thing. When you think about the logic of what's happening, it's horrific. But that's what's great about humour. I think, you know, it's no one's taking that seriously. It's more just the premise that it's an irresponsible product.
Like he says, we need every penny we can get, so...
The character at the end, who's standing proudly next to the bike, looks like the most conservative guy in the world. So it makes me laugh, because I'm thinking, how did that guy convince that woman to do that? And no one's going to take that seriously, but it just accentuates the values of the brand, which is, it's hardcore and, you know, very masculine.
It's that ironic, hey, if, you know, if we're just joking, we can get away with it kind of thing.
There is a rich vein of humour in this country still, which is about male empowerment and making women sex objects, and that's still rife and people still laugh at it, and that's fine.
I don't know what women... With their lad mags and lager, the Men Behaving Badly stuck two fingers up to political correctness.
Jill says it makes them look like objects.
Well, like vases.
Yeah, vase. Nonsense, isn't it?
We've kind of come full circle. And I think to a certain extent it may have come from a backlash against over-the-top, hardline political correctness. But at the end of the day, a lot of what people refer to as post-feminist, postmodern, ironic ladsiness is actually just simple, straightforward, old-fashioned sexist carry on. It's just old-fashioned chauvinism, and even in some of the cleverer and funnier ads, people are just squeezing in tasty-looking women, and they're saying, oh, but she's empowered. She's not being a sex object. Yeah, she's still in her bra and knickers. You know, at the end of the day, you've still got a scantily clad woman hawking the product.
Do you want to flake in that, love? Ta-ra.
The marketing men soon realised that babes could sell beer to the boys. But when model Melanie Sykes was hired by Boddington's, they got more than just a pretty face.
I think what Boddington's did, which was very clever with the Melanie Sykes character, was that they actually poked fun at the advertising world around them.
Initially, you think, oh, you know, they're just relying on attractive modelling, but then they subvert it by the end, where she's kind of the one with the power. She's got the kind of, you know, she hasn't got the accent you necessarily expect her to have.
If you think that's strong, Chuck, try lifting one of these.
We needed someone who looked the part of a kind of Herbert's supermodel, but also was a down-to-earth kind of northern lass who'd happily drink you under the table. Strangely, she was that girl.
The loaded babe soon made way for the ladette, the hard-drinking heroine of sitcoms like Game On. And in ads like this for Club 1830, the girls began behaving as badly as the boys.
Does this make me look cheap?
No, not at all.
The challenge with Club 1830 is how can we produce advertising that resonates with this cynical youth market by being the most honest about what they stand for.
Do you have one that does?
I think what resonated about the makeup ad is that it's played deadpan completely, but there's, at the end of the day, it's just a complete honest appraisal about the intent.
In the early 90s, as the whole sort of ladette and women at football matches and that sort of recognition that women are multidimensional, as often happens, there was a sort of knee-jerk response to that, which blew the whole thing to an extreme. So you did get female empowerment at the expense of men in advertising.
The macho male was left high and dry as ad men put women in the driving seat, in ads like this one for the Toyota Yaris.
So you have now a lot more ads which are supposedly trying to appeal to women. So there's the Toyota Yaris ad where the woman rushes down to move her car in case the window cleaner falls down on it. Well, I think car manufacturers have had to wake up to the fact that women buy cars, that women drive cars. They may not particularly like it, but they have to wake up to the fact that they're their customers now.
It used to be annoying when women were shown as hopeless incompetents, and just as it's annoying now when men are shown as hopeless incompetents. Except at least it used to be a two-way street. Now it's a sort of one-way street, and men aren't allowed to say anything derogatory about women, but women are allowed to say what they want about men. And actually it's so odd because it's the women, it's the men doing the anti-male advertisements mostly.